Hello and welcome to the Designer Beat. This is Steve Adamko, interior designer in Kalamazoo, Michigan, and the host of this YouTube channel. This YouTube channel is all about candid commentary on various interior design subjects and topics, including the good, the bad, and the ugly, telling you like it really is in a radio format. This is going to include commentary, criticism, interpretation, and analysis. And a matter of fact, I've dubbed myself the CIA agent of interior design. Therefore, we'll be giving you the whole truth and nothing but the truth so that you don't have to feel lucky or hope that you're lucky in any type of interior design situation. This is the first installment of this design channel. We're going to start out with, why is the occupation of the interior designer so easily infiltrated? We're living in a day and a time where everybody seems to be an interior designer, an interior decorator. Everywhere you turn, somebody is saying, I'm an interior designer. And they come from various degrees and backgrounds, some with very little background, but they have a flair for color or a flair for this or that. And somebody says, wow, I think you should be an interior designer. And the other person says, well, gosh, I never thought about it that way, but maybe I should. And so they jump into it. And I think this has been perpetuated quite a bit by HGTV. There is some good programming on HGTV, but by and large, a lot of it is not an accurate portrayal of what true interior design is all about and the process that real designers go through to deliver results to a client. It's very interesting today that 75% of the American population gets the majority of its information from television, and 40% of American homes have no books at all. So television is an important aspect of social learning. And in the world today, a vast majority of knowledge is gained not from reading books, but from viewing television. Another interesting tidbit of information and fact is highly educated and economically advantaged families watch less television than do families with less education and lower economic status, probably in part because they have more alternatives. As television viewing among individuals increases beyond 10 hours per week, academic achievement declines rapidly or dramatically. As television viewing among individuals increases beyond 10 hours per week, academic achievement declines dramatically. As a matter of fact, there was a study that found that a linear negative relationship suggests that viewing more than 30 hours a week is associated with low achievement and confusion. When academically successful individuals watch television, they choose content that is more likely to be beneficial than that preferred by low achievers. Hence, it appears that intelligence and achievement may lead individuals to select different types of program content. It is arguable that individuals with more education are more likely to question what they learn. So if individuals that lack education of any kind view design television, they may just accept what they see as true and not question credentials, decisions, etc. of the designers and design programs they view, thus influencing their perception of the interior design profession. The quote-unquote reality of design television. Reality television and design television may seem real to the viewers, but behind reality television, there are the same needs and demands of scripted television. All of the typical needs of creating television are filled by the producers, film editors, cinematographers, production managers, art departments, sound departments, various production assistants, and so forth. Television seems to be describing the world as it is. This is most obvious with news and current affairs programs. These clearly make a claim to be telling the truth and describing the world as it really is. This claim is enhanced by the feeling that television is operating in the present, unlike any other medium. Not only is it describing reality, it is giving us the events as they happen. When trying to determine the difference between reality television from regular scripted television, the line begins to blur a bit. The concept of realism itself is very difficult to define. One can argue that there are three features that distinguish realist television. First, realism offers a quote-unquote window on the world. In the case of television, there is no mediation between the viewer and what he or she is watching. It is as if the television set were a clear sheet of glass, which offers the viewer an uninterrupted vision of what lay behind. Second, realism employs a narrative which has irrationally ordered connections between events and characters. Realist cultural forms, certainly those involving fictional presentations, consist of a cause, logical flow of events, often structured into a beginning, a middle, and a closed conclusion. Events and characters, therefore, do not have a random or arbitrary nature, but are organized by rational principles. The third aspect of realism is the concealment of the production process. Most television is realist in this sense, in that the audience is not made aware during the programs themselves that there is a process of production laying behind the programs. Therefore, the illusion of transparency is preserved. Here is a very significant point. When it comes to actually getting the design television viewers to believe what they are watching is professional interior design performed by interior designers or professional interior designers, it is relatively easy to lead them to believe what they are seeing is real. The more quote-unquote realistic a program is thought to be, the more trusted, enjoyable, and therefore more popular it becomes. Yet realism, too, is an artificial construction. Its quote-unquote naturalness arises not from the nature itself, but from the fact that realism is the mode in which our particular culture prefers its ritual condensations to be cast. There's nothing natural about realism, but it does correspond to the way we currently perceive the world. Several interior design myths are generated through viewing television. The definition of interior design is not clearly understood by the general public. There are several factors that could contribute to misconceptions about interior design and professional interior designers in general. As stated before, the more quote-unquote realistic a program is thought to be, the more trusted, enjoyable, and therefore the more popular it becomes. In reality, the majority of the public is mildly educated about what interior design actually is. Myth number one. The goal of the interior design process is to quote-unquote surprise the client. Surprise is the premise for 95% of the design programming that you will see, when in reality, the client should be an integral, ongoing participant in the design process. Clients and designers should and must work together from the very beginning to ensure that there are no surprises along the way. Good interior design can be achieved through keeping good communication throughout the process between clients and designers. Myth number two, quality and speed are synonymous. The premise that a primary room in your home can be designed, demolished, rebuilt, furnished, and decorated in 2 workdays is a fantasy. It takes a lot of time to create a design concept that supports the client's needs and wants, plus document how it will be constructed, specify the materials, finishes, and furnishings, select contractors and suppliers, build and furnish the space, and resolve any issues that pop up along the way. There's a great sign that says we offer 3 kinds of service: good, fast, cheap. And you can pick any 2. So good and cheap won't be fast. Good and fast won't be cheap. Fast and cheap won't be good. In addition to that, there's another quote that I absolutely love, and it's this. If you think it's expensive to hire a professional, wait until you hire an amateur. Boy, is that ever true. Myth number three. Anyone can be an interior designer. I guess there's a lady, her name is Rebecca Cole, host of Surprise by Design, claims, quote-unquote, if you can do the gestures, you can design a room. Well, that's not true at all. We have a lot of amateurs that are on HGTV. Matter of fact, I met 2 of them at a presentation, and one of them showed a presentation board of her work, and it was like kindergarten level work. And the other one, I said, how did you get to be in front of the camera? And she says, I was behind the camera. And I thought to myself, wow, what a set of credentials to be in front of the camera. So you've got a lot of these people that are really not true interior designers. And just because they're on TV, people think they are true professional designers. They are not. This is a lot of entertainment television. When you really get into the world of interior design, we are talking about an expenditure of time, effort, and money. And you want to do it once right the first time, period. In addition to this myth, the following statement was found offering adult education classes. And this is the quote. So, you've seen Trading Spaces and Decorating Scents, that's C-E-N-T-S, and you are ready to design projects of your own? Our summer class helps individuals design projects and become their own interior designers. In an interview with HGTV's Design Star contestant Adriana Nussbaum, she stated that her design education simply came from living in New York City, and design magazines are her homework while HGTV is her lecture hall. Even as an quote-unquote interior designer named Hildy Santo Tomas, famous from working on Trading Spaces, she has no form of design education. She just claims that interior design was a quote-unquote fun part-time hobby turned job. Qualifications are important for any profession, and interior design is no exception. Professional interior designers are qualified by education, experience, and a qualifying examination, very much like the bar exam. Myth number four. Good design is trendy and cool. Good design can be trendy and cool. However, design is considered good if it satisfies the client's lifestyle needs and is based on the elements and principles of design. More often than not, quote-unquote interior designers, seen on design television shows, bring their personal style to a space that may not be cohesive with the client's needs. Each client is unique, and the design solution should be indicative of the client's needs and style, not the designer's. So right now, we get a lot of designers that people hire that all you get is a stamp, a cookie cutter of what they do, or you get their style. Why is somebody doing that? You're unique, and there's nobody like you in the world ever before and never will be after. So you should have something that's tailored, not somebody's cookie cutter rendition of what they think you should have. I think this is one of the reasons why you see so many namesake firms, Susie Jane Interiors, Billy Bob Interiors, all these things. It's like, well, you know, that's one reason why I call my interior design firm Spectrum Interiors, which denotes a broad range of working. I didn't want to be known as a namesake firm because it seems like, you know, you get their look, their style only. And a lot of the people that are designing out there, they just have a design toolbox that's basically composed of just everything they like, which they apply to you. So then it's not really you, is it? And so they don't do the type of due diligence, asking the right questions to get the right answers, to deliver the right results. In addition to that, not a lot of them have the proper training. They're not trained in architecture. They're not trained in a lot of different things that happen in a space. And interior design takes place in architecture. And it's very much like a hand-in-glove scenario. And so even though I started out wanting to be a carpenter at 5 and then an architect a little later on, I decided interior design would be the perfect blending of all the disciplines. Because with every given building and facade, there's a multitude of things you can do with the interior. So just to bring a good analogy, let's consider a glove as architecture and the hand is the interior design. The glove itself is relatively lifeless without a hand in it. Let's say you shake somebody's hand in a glove. Well, the glove is animated. You can feel somebody's hand when they shake your hand. But once the glove is taken off, it's just a lifeless form. There's no animation to it. So interior design is really the driving animation and the force that makes it all come together. And we live on the inside. So architecture is created to provide in an interior environment for your enjoyment and support and enrichment. Myth number 5, designing your space will be super expensive or super cheap. I mean, there's no middle ground there. Neither is typically true. Professional interior designers provide a contract that spells out fees, timeline, scope of their work on the project. But this is not often seen on design television programs. The professional interior designer will be able to design something that is aesthetically pleasing, functional, and durable, no matter what the budget. Now, obviously, you can't get something great for inexpensive. But that's why when I design, I start at the top in terms of concept. So then, if we have to compromise because of budget constraints, then we have something to retain and keep as far as the aura or the ambiance is concerned. So there's ways to compromise without really compromising. There's ways to compromise on the project without really compromising the project. In other words, there are ways that we can do something relatively inexpensively, but not hamper the whole look and the feel of the finished space. And in some cases, we could just make sure that we have a master plan so that we can implement it over time as the money and time is available. And then another myth, myth number 6, is that interior designers are zany, flamboyant airheads. Well, I don't see that personally that much, though I do see a lack of real expertise in interior design. The truth is, most interior designers are creative business people. They know the impact the spaces they design will make on their clients and others, and that they have a responsibility to not only provide a space that's aesthetically pleasing, emotionally fulfilling, intellectually stimulating, but also protect the health, safety, and welfare of the occupants. So the real reality is that a lot of designers that are seen on television have little or no design education, experience, or certification, and most design programs are created for entertainment to boost records in distribution, ratings, and website traffic. And this was stated by Burton Jablin, president of HGTV. With this combination, one would typically not expect much credibility and accuracy from design television shows if either credibility or accuracy takes time or money away from television networks and all involved. Therefore, what is aired on television may not be and probably isn't an accurate portrayal of interior design. Well, there's probably no probably about it. It isn't an accurate interpretation or representation of interior design or those practicing and licensed in interior design. So this is the state of affairs that we find ourselves in. And so I've always believed that an educated client is a better client, and they're a lot more fun. It's kind of like if I was Andre Agassi and you wanted to play tennis, but you'd never played tennis before, and we went to play and you just couldn't return my serves. You got incredibly frustrated, and I said, hey, wait, hold on a second. I'll tell you, let's do this. Why don't you come back next week? I'll give you some tips. I'll show you how to hold the racket, how to stand, how to stroke through the ball and all of that, and then we'll play after that. How about that? And so the person says, yeah, that'll be good. I can do that. So at a time when they were ready to give up, they come back and get that lesson. And so that, in a sense, narrows the gap, the knowledge gap between me and them. Now we're able to play. They find that they can connect with the ball in the sweet spot of the racket, and it zips across the net, and they are absolutely elated. Well, now you've enhanced that whole scenario. And so all interior design is based on principles that have been established centuries ago. Yes, the techniques may change, but the principles, the foundations, they never change. And there's a lot of people who are not grounded and founded in these principles at all, and therefore they are dangerous. So in today's design culture, we could say, let the buyer beware. You've got to know what constitutes interior design and what constitutes a good interior designer. If you go to my interior design website, KalamazooInteriorDesigner.com, there's a nice rundown about the different roles interior designers play, and they are very important roles. So you don't want to be the client who finds out when it's too late that the designer that they got wasn't at a level that they really needed. Matter of fact, I'll never forget going to the home of an attorney who called me over to look at their space after another interior designer had worked on it. Well, the builder had said that this person, a female, which you find mostly females in the profession, but at the higher end you find mostly men, and there are some wonderful women at the top of the interior design pyramid, but there's a vast amount in the middle and below that are mostly women. Nothing wrong with that, but let's not get the idea that just because they're a woman, they have this under wraps and they've got a corner on the market. They don't. A lot of them, they might dress sharp, but they're not really sharp when it comes to design. Design is a 3D walk-in environment. It surrounds you. It impacts you. You've got to have the right backgrounds in order to make the foregrounds of furniture and fabric and people able to be presented correctly so that they're looked at in the very best lighting and conditions. So back to the story here about the attorney who invited this lady in based on the recommendation of the builder who said, oh, she's awesome, she's fantastic, she's all this and that. Well, I got there and things were out of scale to the space that they were supposed to go in. For certain furniture pieces couldn't go where they were designed because they didn't fit properly and they had to go somewhere else. And so I'll never forget what he said, and this is his quote exactly. The builder told me, he said, that she was all this and that and basically, you know, fantastic and wonderful. But he said he never told me that her work sucked. What a bad situation. You know, this lawyer, this attorney, had a lot of money. He lived in a gated community. In other words, there was a gated community, but then every home sat on an acre or two or three with its own gate. So this was a very nice area. But not everybody has money that they can reinvest if they so desire. Some people, they've got enough money to do it, but they better do it right once the first time, and you better make sure that you have the right designer to pull it off that can address the whole system, the whole scenario. You have to have a designer. You have to have a designer that looks at things holistically and all the interrelated factors so that every move you make sets you up for success for the next move, particularly if you have to do this over time, because not everyone can afford to do it in one fell swoop. Well, we're at the conclusion of this first installment, and I hope it's been enjoyable and eye-opening and revealing to you. We've got a lot more coming your way, so stay tuned, subscribe to this channel. This is Steve Adamko, founder and owner of Spectrum Interiors, wishing you a great and wonderful, beautiful day.